Bedford, Indiana. David Norris grew up here, dreaming of being a basketball star. But his parents and their devotion to the strict guidelines of the Mormon Church got in his way.
The biggest thing for me was that I couldn't play basketball on Sunday because I mean, basketball was my life. And what that meant was that I couldn't be on the All-Star team.
But David's issues went much deeper.
The problem wasn't with the Mormon Church, it was really with me. And it wasn't that the rules and the structure and all that was bad for me. I just didn't like that. I didn't want to be told what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. I felt like I was, you know, being forced or driven to have to adhere to certain regulations or certain standards that I hadn't chosen for myself to live by.
As David got older, he became angry. He was trapped in a world he hated.
And it grew into just outer rebellion. So there was such an emptiness and such a void in my life that I began to turn to things that I thought would make me look cool to other people and help me to fit in with certain other crowds.
He turned to pot and cocaine, and that soon led to meth.
It is a mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual war with meth addiction. And I was literally losing my mind. I was in a war.
Now he was trapped in another world, and once again, he struggled to get out.
Most addicts would just rather stay sick and addicted than they would go through the sickness of getting clean. And that was me, you know, and it just digressed. The more you use, the more you had to have.
That cycle of addiction continued for 10 years. Even as he was destroying his life, he felt God's unrelenting pursuit.
I believe that God was pursuing me. God's always been pursuing me, but I've always pushed him away.
David went to jail for 9 months for possession of marijuana while out on bond. There, he met several men who told him about forgiveness and salvation through Jesus Christ.
I began to read the Bible, and I didn't understand a thing. I didn't understand nothing in the Bible. It didn't make sense to me. So I asked God to send me something that I could understand, you know, and I was just real specific with God, and it was just between me and him. I didn't share it with anybody else. I said, God, I said, if you are real, give me a comic book version of the Bible. And I was just real serious about that, you know? And one day at lunchtime through the bean hole, the little hole they send the trays in, the food came flying, a little comic book version of the Bible landed right at my feet. You know, I hadn't told anybody about it but God. So when I looked down and seen that, I just had to say, okay, I believe you're real.
While that convinced David that God was real, he went back to his old ways after his release. One night, one of his drug buddies, Travis, overdosed on heroin. David had a choice to make.
I could throw away the heroin that I had in my pocket and go in and help my friend, or I could keep the heroin that I had and leave him there and possibly die. And the sad thing is that I chose to leave him there. Well, a day later, he calls me and I said, man, brother, I said, I'm so sorry that I did what I did to you last night. And he said, you know what? He said, it's cool. He said, because I'd done the same thing to you. And that just shook me to my core. Because not only had I become like that everybody in that culture was the same way. We all only thought of ourselves, and we all only cared about ourselves. And at that moment, I mean, that just moved something in me that I said to Travis, I said, you know what? He asked me, the next question was, do you need any dope? I said, no, Travis, I'm done. I kicked the heroin habit, and it was horrible.
But he was still empty, still searching, still hungry for something more. 4 months later, he decided once again to pick up a Bible.
Something came up behind me and just kind of just wrapped its arms around me and just consumed me. I just began to cry. I just began to sob. I was so sorry. And I mean, I was really, truly, for the first time, really repentant for the hurt that I'd caused to other people. It wasn't, God, I'm sorry that my life's a mess. It was, God, I'm sorry that everybody around me's life's a mess because of me. And I need you. And he changed me.
That night, David gave his life to Christ. He's been drug-free for over 15 years. He and his wife Joy also opened Heaven Neve, a recovery ministry for men. David knows God has brought him a long way, but he also knows he's a work in progress.
Learning how to be compassionate, merciful, and loving, caring, has been a long, hard road for me because I was such a hard man. But at the same time, God uses that hardness that I had to be able to deal with men that are just like I was. I mean, who else to be able to understand what they're going through and what they're thinking than someone that was just like them? For me and for my life, and I think for most, God says to us, I'm not so worried about changing your circumstances. I'm more concerned about changing you.